Yeah, I've got a lot to say about analytics. Who's here for the analytics talk? Really? Nobody? Nobody's confused here? I was disappointed. I was like going to trap you and shut the door and no one could leave. You have to like listen to some completely unrelated thing. Yeah, this was a last minute change, so thank you for being flexible here. I hope that this is, we have the resolution. Okay, so let's get started. I'm torn with this topic because I, like you, am an engineer of sorts, engineering mentality, so scientist. And talking about social code or code quality or the aesthetics, it kind of bothers me. You know, because everyone can have an opinion. This is like a classic bike shedding topic. Like everyone has an opinion about code formatting and you know, the way something looks. It's not a very hard discipline. I want to kind of take it and turn it into a hard discipline. Now, for some of you, what we're going to cover, you'll have seen before. So you'll be like, yeah, this is what I do. I'm into that. But for a lot of you, and I would actually put myself in this category because I'm relatively new at this, this approach is going to be new. It's not just aesthetics. It's not just a feel good, you know, great, I'm a craftsman here. I feel good about my work. I feel morally righteous. It's actually very practical and very valuable to what you do as a programmer. Before I get into this, how many people are programmers? Anyone? Yeah, everyone's a programmer. Okay, good. That's right. I mean, everything is software today, so I would expect that. I think we have maybe one person who does hardware. We were talking about soldering last night, so that's clearly hardware. So I'm going to talk about this topic of programming. And when I learned programming, it was very much about how to get the computer to do what you wanted it to do. And that's generally what I think we think of when it comes to programming. When we write software, it's I want the system to behave in a particular way. Therefore, I'm going to control it. I'm going to make it do my bidding. I think that this model of programming as controlling systems, it's certainly accurate. It's certainly what we do. But I think actually, more importantly, it's about a social dynamic. And you know, folks are undoubtedly using Git these days, or distributed version control. A distributed version control system, or revision control system, is necessarily social. So in the last 5 to 10 years, depending on how quickly you've adopted this, you've experienced very, 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 in a very real way, social coding. In fact, that's what GitHub calls itself, right? Or it used to. Maybe it still does. So I'm actually not going to be talking about that. I'm going to be talking about a dynamic in programming that respects a communication line from one human being to another. It isn't just collaborating on revision control, pull requests, passing things along. It's about how you write your software to express yourself, to communicate your intention. So we talk about in programming this concept of correctness. I'm always uneasy when it comes to a statement like something is correct or incorrect, because it has this moral overtone. And I don't like moral, you know, anything when it comes to software. I like my software to be completely amoral, void of any kind of, you know, religiosity. So the term correctness for me is a little bothersome. I like rather intent, the word intention. So as a programmer, I can look at software and say, is the intention of this author clear to me or not clear? And this is the heart of what is social. So I'm going to give you a story here. This is 2 years ago, roughly. I woke up, I think it was a Saturday morning, and I was going to do work. So this is day job stuff on a Saturday. That's how excited I was to do this work. And I pulled this block of code up. And this is what I had to modify in order to make an enhancement to the system. This is production code, it was running in production, and it is literally the exact code that I was looking at. And something in me just kind of broke. Something just snapped. This code isn't that bad. But for me at that moment in time, I was really looking forward to solving some problems. I didn't want to have to go back and read somebody's code here that looked like this. And after I took about 5 or so minutes to just kind of see what's going on here, because I had to modify this, right? So I had to make changes to it. So I had to understand what was going on. I couldn't just start changing things and pulling wires and moving things around. I needed to understand it. So I was forced to read it. I was forced to deal with the brain that originally wrote this thing. And I became angry. I'm literally blood pressure up, and I said, this is ridiculous. After I spent 5 minutes with this, I realized exactly what was going on here. And it was completely trivial. But I had to spend 5 minutes to figure out what it is. So as a part of this talk, what we're going to do is take this code and translate it into an expression or a series of expressions that reflect thought, reflect reasoning, that in fact is social. This is antisocial code. I wrote this code. It's my code. I wrote it. And I did. You know, I don't remember what I write. You know, 2 weeks later, I forget what I write. So writing social code isn't just for other people. It's for you as well. And that thing that broke in me launched me on a path to never write software like this again, to be social and to be respectful. And the premise here is that being social in your code is like being social in language, in any form of communication, written or spoken. When we communicate, we're respectful. We speak slowly. If somebody doesn't understand, we simplify. We take care to communicate clearly. This code does not take care to communicate clearly. It is wild and it is unleashed. It is like a Tourette's explosion of inappropriate behavior. And you're like, does that person have a problem? Yes, actually, this person does have a problem. So what we're gonna do is rewrite this thing in a way that is social. And in this exercise, we're gonna see, I hope to demonstrate that it isn't aesthetics that we're talking about, but it is respect and clarity and indeed social behavior, respect for other human beings, that's the center of programming. Not just being a nice person, but actually what we do as programmers. We're gonna do some code gazing. What you do is you let your eyes relax and it's like a stereoscope and this 3D image comes at you. You said, oh, I get it, I understand now. No, of course not. You look at this and break it down piece by piece and you say, what's going on here? So I did that. So let's just do that. Let's just do that so we can get a kind of a handle on this, because it does look a little intimidating, it looks a little ugly, but with some care, we'll see it's not that bad. What's going on? So we have a log statement. Let's drop that. Logs are easy. But then we have here what appears to be a collection of things. Name equals, we're gonna do a verify on that. User equals, password, it looks like we're collecting some things here. Options, okay, we're collect, we've got some things. Now here, it looks like we're creating a database with the things that we created. Very common pattern, right? I'm gonna do something, I'm gonna kinda define my arguments to that thing that I'm gonna do, right? So I do that thing here, I call create database, and then I handle the result. In this case, by the way, we're looking at Erlang. Who recognizes this as Erlang? Awesome. Who writes Erlang? Who uses, who's, okay, excellent, very good. Wow, we're making progress here, great. Okay, so this is a pattern matcher that says, okay, this was a good result here. And I'll get into some of these details later for everyone's benefit. And this is a bad thing. So we're collecting arguments. We are performing some operation using them, and we're handling the result. And when I saw that, I said, Garrett, man, why? This doesn't have to be so intimidating and weird looking and complicated. It's very simple. It's a very simple function. And then I proceeded to rewrite it. And that's what we're going to do. So the essence of this thing is actually not this implementation. I'm going to rewrite this with a pass of my hand to be completely and accurately, completely correct. Here we go. This is indeed what's going on. We're handling an AMQP message. So before we jump into the implementation, let's tell the story here, because it starts before we implement it. It's actually about handling, AMQP is a message protocol. It's a bunch of other things as well, but we're pulling a message off of a queue, and we have DB create, that means I'm gonna create a database. All right, that's the meaning of this message, and we have some payload here, that's the message, and then we have some state, that's housekeeping for the Erlang stuff. And what we're gonna do here is we're simply gonna dispatch this thing to a handle DB create message function. That's it. We're completely finished with this exercise. We're done. We can walk away from this because we know that we have solved the problem. Right? We're not done yet, but my point here is that we actually are done. If you're interested in the big story, which is essentially taking a db.create message and farming it off to a specific function that creates the message, we are completely and unequivocally finished with this exercise. So when I read this thing, I know what it does. Now we're going to do some more, because I know this would be very disappointing if we stopped there. What we want to do is, this is the interesting part, we're going to handle the DB create. So what I did here is I simply copied and pasted the code. There isn't a single thought going on. It's a mechanical refactoring decompositional exercise. So I went from, you know, this higher level thing, handle AMQP, now this is the actual function that handles it, and this is just the copy paste of the wall of text. So don't worry about that. Right, so you know, we did our exercise here, so I'm back to, okay, we've got a log, I've got some collection of arguments here, I've got a create database, and I'm handling the result. Maintain those about four or five things. right? Here we go. This. This whole thing is actually this. So let's take a moment and read this. Handle DB create message consists of log, right? We're going to collect the arguments to the DB create arguments, right? We're collecting them here, creating that. We're calling DB create, this is kind of our workhorse here, and we're handling the result. All of this code is in fact just this in terms of the implementation. And had I seen this rather than that, I would have been a very happy person because this is completely unambiguous. It's completely clear. It's social. It's respectful. If I had taken the time to actually write this clearly the first time, that morning with coffee would have been pleasant rather than disturbing. Right? But there's more payoff. I will highlight the payoff. It's more than just an emotional feel good. There's actual value here. So we're going to do this. We're going to push through all of these different functions and see how this is implemented. And at each step, we're going to say, let's go from antisocial behavior coding practice to social. So we're going to keep doing that. And what you're going to see here is that there's a thought process involved. This question of what's going on here is more than just how to make your code pretty. It's programming. You're asking and answering the question, what's going on here is programming. So what we're going to do here is program. We're not making code beautiful. We're actually writing code. We're writing code the way it should be written in a way that we can later understand it and so can our colleagues. So of course we're done here, but we have more to do. Let's take a look at the DB create arguments. This is another wall of code. And I'm using, what I'm doing here is basically passing the logic. This is one step here. I need to basically reflect the arguments in some return structure here. So in Erlang, it's called a record. So I'm basically collecting the data and passing it back as a record. It's just a little container. It's actually a tuple. And we're just going to pass it back. But here we have another wall of code. And while it's not as bad, it still is not completely obvious. You can't look at this in 10 seconds or so and figure out what's going on. And you might be tempted to think that it's doing more than it actually is. Again, it smacks of sort of antisocial behavior. So let's rewrite that. So here what I'm doing is I'm delegating the argument generation, the argument creation to these separate functions. I'm going to make one step here to make that a little bit clearer. So I'm going to go from that to that. Now we're getting into personal preferences, and I happen to find this slightly clearer. So it kind of shows that this DB create args, is collecting some values and returning the result. This I can look at in a glance and say, ah, no problem. There's no demons here. This is simple and clear and unambiguous. And now I have these little helper functions that are going to actually do the work for me. And I think this name is actually pretty reasonable. But look at the implementation. What is going on here? Now we have really clear code. We're getting a required argument called name, and we're verifying it. This is almost like a schema, a schematic. Right, where we're just describing sort of the behavioral properties or the data structure. So we're taking a functional language and we're pushing it all the way down to a level that is very declarative and helps us to, at a glance, understand the logic. This is, in my opinion, social. It's respectful. I don't get anxious here. I actually get kind of happy because I get it. You know, and if there's a change to something in here, I know exactly where to go. Required arguments, a specific verify DB. And I do the same thing with the other ones. DB create user arg, so this is collecting the user from the message. So it happens to be required. Password, right, also happens to be required. And now here's the complicated one. If we went back to the original, we'd see that this is kind of a case expression. In Erlang, this is called a case expression. It's an Erlang case expression. And what we're doing is we're going to evaluate the result of this part of the expression. So this is a function call, so we're going to take the result of that, and we're going to pattern match against the body here, these clauses. So if the result of this attribute is nothing, so it's undefined, this is convention in Erlang, then our options list here is going to be empty. Right? But if we have something, that is, it is defined, so it's other than undefined, now we're going to include this as a part of our options. Right? So this is a little bit of logic that is tagged with this function name. So we had maybe, 12 or so folks who use Erlang. How many people are religious fanatics about using case expressions? Okay, that was a bit of a trap there. I don't know if you're okay. He's totally confident, you're assured there. How many religiously don't use them? Okay, so there's some people who are pragmatists. They're in between. I'm more on the religiously don't use, but I do occasionally use them. So it's okay. We're all friends here. There's something that we can do to this to improve it. And guess what? It involves a function. What we can do here is rather than sort of spelling out our logic, we can create a handler function that is specifically designed to deal with this logic, this sort of mapping logic. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get the attribute, the cluster attribute off the message, and I'm going to return that options list as a result of this. This is spelling out clearly a very subtle sort of logical decision here. The only options available to this particular function is cluster. That's it. We're not accumulating a bunch of different things. We're not actually creating, so this is fine, this is legal, but it's buried in here, it's implicit. So by adding a function here, I can name this thing to make that decision a little bit clearer. The db create options arg is actually just a function of cluster option, that's all it is. And that's a decision that I made as a programmer. So it's a signal, it's a social cue, right? It's polite, it's respectful, it helps to articulate that. So here's that function. Functions are named case expressions, here's that function. Clustered options, undefined, empty list. Clustered option, cluster. So we basically take the same pattern matching that we see in the case expression and apply it at the function level. And this is the point. Functions are named case expressions. So if in Erlang you use a lot of case expressions, consider using functions, handler functions, and you get to name things. And you get to think about, so I actually came up with this name by forcing myself to spell things out rather than just coding sort of in an imperative style, if this, do this, 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 this. So by moving to a more functional model, we become more descriptive. In order to be descriptive, we have to understand what we're doing. Right? And understanding what we're doing and communicating that clearly to ourselves and others is what? What's the theme here? Social. Yeah, that's right. You got it. Don't have to worry. There's no trick here. It's social. I think it is. Okay, so that's that. Okay, so here is our, back, you know, we're going back to the original message handler, and this is the straightforward story that's going on here. It shouldn't be controversial at this point. So I'm going to stop and ask, do you guys see what's going on here? Do you like it? Do you buy it? Is it silly? Is it just a matter of like personal expression and artistry, or is there substance to it? Thoughts? No. Okay, so I've got two people who like it. So that means I guess everyone else is like, no, sorry.
The problem I have with it is that your idea of what's social is subjective, and I'd have done something which I think social would have gone slightly different in the refactoring. So it's...
Yeah, well, I find that comment to be offensive. No, the comment was that being social is a matter of opinion, and it's subjective. And I think that's true within certain bounds. But somebody suffering from Tourette's, for example, does clinically, measurably, extremely antisocial behavior as a tick, as a neurological problem. So that's what that original code was. The opinions differ. The opinions differ, but I think within reason, we're all behaving ourselves relatively socially here. So I think that's fine. Now, I could see some people becoming extremely antisocial. This is sort of what I'm talking about, and I'm going to say that most code is that. It's the extremely antisocial behavior. And we get this sort of wild, crazy environment in our code, in the code that we have to deal with, and somehow that's acceptable. And actually, it shouldn't be acceptable from ourselves and for others. So I'd like to sort of introduce this concept of being polite and respectful to others, including ourselves. How many people use this method? How many people write code this way? Okay, well, wow, all right, well, we're done, we're fine. All right, so let's just keep going with this, because there's some points here that come out of this that might be surprising. It might not for those who are practitioners of this have seen this, but I think to a lot of us, and especially, I mean, when I started doing this thing, literally that morning was when I say something broke, I'm not kidding. Like, I got really upset and said, this is ridiculous, I'm done with this. And I embarked on a strategy, like an experiment, to see what would happen if I just wrote code this way. And so this was, I'm convinced now after a couple years of doing this that this is, I will never ever go back. Only from sheer laziness and rudeness to others. And sometimes I feel lazy and rude, but at least I know the right path. And we have included in here the result handler. Now, what's wrong with this? Again, stereoscopic, eyes glazed over, I have to spend cycles reading it, figuring it out. If I'm gonna do that, and I'm gonna figure it out, let's spell it out clearly. So what I'm doing here, this db create is simply, I'm going to create a, this particular function is really just a pass through to this guy here. So it is stacks MySQL controller, create database, and then the arguments. And in this case, we have a record. We've introduced a little container to simplify our management of the arguments. And so we're passing that along. But all we're doing is passing it along to this thing. So that's very simple. That's a mechanical refactoring, creating a function to wrap another function. And here's the result. And again, I've gone from a case expression to functions, because functions are what? Named case expressions. Quite literally. I mean, if you look at the beam code that's generated, they get translated into case expressions. So they're literally named case expressions. But the name helps us to understand and reason what they're doing, what they're about. So I'm handling the db create, and I have two results. I have an OK, which is happy. This is a tuple. These curly brackets make a tuple. We've got a two-tuple. This is a common convention in Erlang. There is no type system in Erlang. I mean, there's a primitive low-level types, but there's no higher-level type system or types. So we, by convention, tag tuple. So this is means good. Means I'm happy. This one, on the other hand, says bad. It's an error. And so we're handling the two cases, something it worked and it didn't work. In the case where it worked, okay, now we're doing our reading. We're doing something weird here. I'm going to make a comment about that in a second. And then we're doing a reply with some result here. Okay, I got that. And then the error case, I'm logging a stack trace, and then I'm returning some error to the okay. So it's starting to get simpler, but it can be made better. And here's a point. This thing in here. Is anyone looking at that wondering what that does? Yeah, that morning I did. That took me 2 hours to figure out. I'm like, what's going on here? Why did I do this? You know, why did I write this thing? I had no idea. So I was, you know, grepping and searching and asking and like, what could this possibly mean? It bothered me. I don't want this arbitrary, like, weird tuple in here. You know, what's going on? So as it turns out, this is a decision for backward compatibility. So without this, something broke. And of course, I didn't comment it. I didn't bother to write a comment. Comments. The code should be self-evident here. And obviously, at that time, it was self-evident to me. But later on, it wasn't, right? Reasonably so. Antisocial behavior on my part. So what I'm going to do here, keep an eye out for this. I'm going to do something tricky with this. Okay. So here's the result. This is clarified. And this is a dispatch pattern. I'm basically taking some condition and just farming it off to a specific handler. So I'm not making any real decision here. I'm just basically, it's just filtering. It just is a routing layer. So if it's okay, it's going to go to handle db created, success case. If it's an error, it's going to go to handle db create error. Any controversy in that? What's with the what? The underscore? Oh, here, yeah. So in Erlang, this is a signal that this argument is not used in the body of this function. So the compiler will not complain. That's just a convention, and the compiler recognizes that convention. Yeah, but really hasn't. This is still a bound variable. So anyway, detail with Erlang. Okay, so here's the success case, and here is that weird code again. So now it's really starting to show up. We're whittling our code down and down and down, and little weird decisions like this, which I didn't see this in the original code. It was lost in that stereoscope, like it was, you know, the arm of the creature coming at me. I just didn't see it. Right, but here, in the light of day, I see what's going on here. And what I'm going to do is clarify this in this way. So what I'm going to do is take this thing and create a response from it. So what I'm doing is I'm doing several things here. I've got some logic here. I'm creating some attributes. And then I'm passing that to message response. What I really want to do is just this. Handle db created is a reply with a db created response. It's almost completely ridiculously stupid. There's almost no work going on here, except a decision, right? That db created is a function of some tagged tuple here. It's a reply with a response, right? And then here's, of course, the function, db created response. And here's what I did with this weird thing. I put it into this apply db created legacy attributes. Now, I'm not thrilled with the name. I went to bed that night, and I, you know, turned and tossed and feverish. Obsession over the wrongness of this name, but it kind of gets in the ballpark. It's certainly better than nothing at all, right? So I'm going to take my standard attributes here, my host info attributes, right? Right, that's what I'm doing. And I'm going to apply to that this weird thing, apply db created legacy attributes. Actually, it's a good name. I like this name, right? And then I return that. Then they just pass that onto the message response. And here's this function here. Apply db created legacy attributes is this blob. I tagged it. Right, I named it. I made a decision to clarify what that was. It's in my opinion, this is extremely clear. Like, I can look at that and say, oh, somebody is applying some legacy attributes, and then you can look at this code to see what it is. And here's the win. Functions are good for naming decisions. And if you're a functional language wonk and like that sort of thing, you're like, duh. If you're not, it's true. You can use functions in all sorts of things. And too much stereoscopic noise here, so I created a little helper function. Arguably, I have diminishing returns at this level. So this might get into your point of, you know, what's social to you, you know, what is the standard. I just want to get to the point where we have kind of a reasoned discussion about it and somebody's not shouting senselessly in the corner, banging the walls. Right, that's an extreme case. And I really think that that first iteration of that function was somebody in the corner just pounding, just angry, and trying to get out of the room. Here we go, speaking of him. This guy is gone. So when you were afraid earlier, you're like, oh, this is Erlang, and it's really big, and it's towering, and it looks terrible. He's gone. You don't have to worry about this. There's no fear, no trepidation. You don't have to spend that 5 minutes. You know, 5 minutes isn't a long time. But it felt like a long time because it was really very, very simple. Here's the original function. Here's the refactored functions. Just take a minute to look at those. Now, I know what you're thinking. I know what you're thinking right now. You're thinking, you know what, Garrett? You had me right up until this slide, because this actually is not that bad. If this is what you're arguing for, a bunch of functions, how is this not stereoscopic? Okay, it's flat. The code formatting is nice. But is it obvious? Is it self-evident what's going on here when you just look at all that code? He's saying, no, it's not. I actually sort of agree with you, but I also disagree. This is certainly not obvious. Moving to this, there's a temptation to think that this was a bad decision. But I'm going to try to persuade you that it was a good decision. So first of all, I'm going to concede this point, that this approach requires more functions. That's the point. We're using functions to essentially articulate our thinking. So we would expect more functions. So I think that's fair. That's one of the costs. We definitely have more lines of code. This will result in more lines of code. And you're going to say, well, more lines of code means more bugs. All things equal, true. That's true. All things held constant, more lines of code have to mean more bugs because bugs show up in lines of code. That's a fact. So I will concede that point that you get more lines of code. However, your code is your functions are much, much shorter. And short functions are functions that become embarrassingly obvious. You look at them and you think, wow, why did somebody take the trouble to do so little in this function? And I will show you the beauty of that in a moment. But I want to make a point about this, you know, this idea of writing responsibly, of morally, right, socially. By taking the time to break all that logic down and spell it out clearly, the person who now looks at that indeed has more functions to consider. But I'll show you in a second. When you look at the functions, at every point along the way, you're dealing with clear thinking and clear expression. You're dealing with a social being, respectful being. So this is the problem with the huge block of functions, the number of functions. This is why this is actually not a problem. Today, or in this room right now, everybody here is, well, most of you are focused up here, and I'm focused on you. So we are selectively focusing respectively on one another. In this room, there's all sorts of other things going on. There's the beamer, the projector, there's sounds going on over here. There's my phone, which I didn't turn off, is beeping constantly. I don't know what's going on over there. I have been focusing on that, trying not to. But we have selective focus. Right? And what we're doing here is we're creating an arena where we can selectively focus. And this is about levels. So if you get into physics or biology or chemistry, you realize that at a certain point along the way, when you look at something, it becomes something else. When you look at biology, it becomes organic chemistry. When you look at chemistry, right, you're dealing with physics. And at some point along the way, you kind of pop out of a level. Right? But at every point along the way, you can still be rational and well-reasoned about it. And this is what we're doing here. When we look at all of this code here, we're creating a matrix of different things that when you look at it in its totality, you think, this is terrible, I'm confused, you've lost me. But if you look at any one point, and these are all different levels, this is the high level stuff, this is sort of medium level, and it gets down to some lower level things, at any point along the way, you're gonna see something that's well reasoned. So the thing bad about looking at the universe, versus looking at the microscopic levels. It's what you want to look at. We never manage all this stuff in our brains at the same time anyway. We don't have to do that with code. We can write our code, our systems, our technology in a way that just lets them evolve. You don't try to account for every little detail and manage this as a mental model all the time, the high level, the medium, the low level. You'd be tempted to do that in that first function. That's one monolithic view to the entire problem. It is incomprehensible. You have to manage all of these, you know, moving parts all at the same time, all this context, all these different things. And this is Erlang. This is pretty good. We don't have global state. We don't have, you know, weird things that can bite us, weird side effects that can bite us, some side effects. But nothing like, say, Python or C. I mean, in some of these programs where you have big monolithic bunches of blocks of code that's incomprehensible, that code is terrible. It breaks. Mapping it down into small things gives us level views. So let's look at the high-level stuff. This is handling the AMQP message. So if I'm interested in the high-level stuff, boom, I take a look at that. Right? Here's handling the AMQP message, handling the DB created. That's the big story. So if you're coming into this thinking, I want to understand what the big topic is, look at this. Don't look at all this stuff. Don't worry. Don't sweat it. And when you look at your code base, you don't look at all the modules at once. You have these abstractions that help you to focus in on something that's of interest. By writing small functions, you are necessarily focusing your attention at any point on a very, very cogent, clear, well-reasoned bit of logic. That's what you do as programmers. That, to me, is what programming is. So if we're not doing that, I'm going to kind of argue with the social argument here, this social backdrop, that you're not kind of not programming. You're kind of just hacking, maybe. You're kind of like telling the computer what to do. But you've abandoned the social element. So that's the big picture. Here's sort of the medium level if you're interested in what's going on with the arguments. So these are all the functions related to the arguments. It's not that bad. You've got a top level one and the little workers here. At any point along the way, you can reason about what's going on. Right, creating the DB, handle the result. We create the DB, we handle the results, and then there's some miscellaneous functions, right, some other things. And we could comment these, we could try to organize them, or we could just let them go. There's tools that you can sometimes use, depending on your language, to visualize things. So there's ways of handling the complexity as these things grow, but the main point is that you're expressing yourself deliberately and clearly and socially. Okay, so why is this? Okay, we've talked about that. I'm not going to say the word social anymore. Right? That's my contract to you. I'm going to try. Right? This is really the point. And this is what I've seen. So this came out of, like, I just said, I'm going to try this and see what happens. So this is an experiment. I'm curious to see, over a period of years, what happens. Like, is there a payoff to this? Because this is a lot of work. Right? We went from this big monolithic thing that worked to, like, really beating the daylights out of it to this, like, this list of small functions that reflected a lot of very careful thinking, rigorous thinking. So is there a payoff to that? Here's the payoff that I've observed. When it comes time to revisiting the software, you have created a logical map of things that must necessarily change if you're going to change the software. Shouldn't be controversial. If you're going to change the software, you're going to be changing the software, you're going to be changing the code here. And the things that you touch are extraordinarily focused. And so the logic, the reasoning that you go through to say, well, how does this change impact the code? You've got a map. So it says, oh, it's here, and it's here, and it's here, or it's just here. It isn't, okay, I've got a little bit in this function, I've got a little bit over here, I've got, you know, in this block of, this big monolithic block of code. It's this logic has changed. I have seen this over and over again. The payoff is remarkable. You enter a change scenario calmly. Have you ever been afraid of changing code? Like truly, you know, like you know that if you make a change to this code, it's going to make it worse. That's a pretty common thing. Everyone should raise their hand here. Everyone can be honest here. Everyone has seen that. You look at code and you're like, I'm going to make this change. I'm pretty sure it's going to make it worse. It's that kind of code that we're avoiding here. Because we're going to make a change, and no change is going to touch every single point. It'll touch a high level or a low level. The high level may obviate and may eliminate the need for a whole bunch of functions. But it'll only ever affect one particular point. So you have this map. Debugging becomes much easier. You say, well, what's wrong? Debugging is the flip side of an enhancement, right? It's the same, but we're going to change it to improve it in some way. So the same arguments apply. Testing becomes easier. And I found this. So this is another material payoff. I actually, and this is controversial, a lot of people don't like to hear this, but I test much less. I am much less afraid. I've been in situations where there's just a bunch of code, and I just know that it's so fragile that at any point in time I could see this thing falling apart. And the response to that very rationally is we're just going to test the living daylights out of this thing. This thing makes you put so much thought up front, and every decision is so kind of discrete and isolated and becomes obvious. You're just like, you know, honestly, there's no bugs in this thing. That sounds arrogant, it sounds like, you know, I'm, you know, sort of reveling in hubris here and I'm going to be punished by the gods, but I've seen it to be the case. This just generates a lot higher quality code. There's no type system in here, by the way, so I'm not relying on a compiler. I mean, you can get things that break here, but overall, I do test less. So I find myself paying off some of the time up front to do the sort of logical decomposition by spending relatively less time testing. Yeah. So the questions are, you know, how violently do you punish people who don't follow this? And the answer is with extreme force. Yeah, unapologetic force. You humiliate them. And then the other one is, I'm just kidding, I'll get back to that. I'm sorry, was this the second one? What? How do you encourage it? Yeah, how do you develop a sort of a culture around this? So spotting code that doesn't follow this convention is pretty simple. At least in Erlang world, big functions are bad. So if your functions are small and have a few lines, I almost don't care. I know that if the code works at all, it's probably correct. I don't think I can rigorously prove that, like mathematically, but I've just seen that to be the case. So code reviews are trivial. I mean, if you believe in that sort of thing anyway. I don't believe in sort of bludgeoning people. I think that, you know, that's another social element. Allow people to find their own way. But I found that folks who have seen this adopt it. It sticks. People try it, they like it, they like the experience, they like the results. So it tends to kind of sell itself. I'm not a believer in, like, you know, enforcing. But if you were one, it's easy to spot. You know, big monolithic, you just look at it. If it looks like a stereoscope, if there's too many things that are bothering your eyeballs, it's time to kind of refactor and move these decisions into some lower level functions. So I've heard some objections. What was an objection? Well, one was, you know, this is a bit subjective. So the standard of being social or not social is a matter of opinion. I think that's true. But what I'm trying to do is just get us in sort of a place where we can have a reasoned discussion as opposed to tantrums or other behavior that we shouldn't tolerate. Any other objections? People who don't like this, yeah.
I see where you're going. I mostly agree with it. I think in this particular case, you might have gone too far. I think context of a function, well, the context of a piece of code is important. By making everything flat, you've removed information. Oh. So well, you've gone to set up, say, 3 2-line functions. I would have stayed with just 1 6-line.
Yeah. So the point there is about context, and you indeed change your context when it comes to functions. I would argue that you are actually clarifying your functions because, or your context. Your context becomes the arguments to the function. So if you look at the first function, we had a lot of context, but they're kind of free floating context. And you didn't know where one applied to something else. You didn't know what the relationships were there. By pushing all those into functions, you necessarily define exactly the contract involved in performing that operation. So you're narrowing your context, you're making it more precise, and so I think you still have it. I think it's just more precisely defined and more reasoned.
I was thinking of the visual context. The fact that certain code is indented, these things belong together in some way. And it's your naming conventions, I suppose, which now identify things that belong together.
So there are tools that, you know, that could map. So the observation is that just, you know, forget the context in terms of variables being global or stack variables. So I misunderstood the original point. The original point was that you've really lost kind of your, it sounds, context or even code structure organization, how things relate to one another. You know, going back to some of these points of, you know, here are the different categories. I had to go in and look at that and sort of reason about, okay, this is the, you know, the big picture. That's the big picture stuff. It wasn't marked. I think it's possibly a weakness, and I certainly spend time reasoning about those things. But there are tools, I don't use them, but there are tools that will allow you to sort of view call chains. So you can kind of see what, you know, the exported functions, the public-facing functions are the ones that would be your starting point that someone could call, and then you could kind of map, see how things are going. I don't think I would go back to my original argument that, you know, when as humans we just don't maintain full state of everything. We selectively focus. And this lets you do that. The other thing just doesn't. You have no ability to selectively focus at all. You're just kind of, you're holding this piece over here and then this one over here, and you're like, okay, here's the relationship, I think. By doing this mechanically, you define your relationships explicitly. And I think that's a big step in being clear. Yeah.
So I think I like this context argument as an argument.
Okay.
So what I find is if you break things out into small functions, let's say you've got this dbcreate thing, and maybe you create another dbcreate thing at some point in the future. And obviously, this contains quite a lot of similar code. Probably you'll end up calling the same code, because you probably want it to have very much the same influence. And if you change one of them, you want to change the other one as well. This is almost certainly what you want as the end behavior, so the function calls will be the same. Now, some of your calls that are a part of the dbcreate or dbcreate2 or whatever your other one is, mm-hmm. are separate in the code.
So I think, you know, I'll buy the argument that, you know, you could, rather than saying let's, I mean, honestly, you don't see a lot of like argument generation functions. The fact that I use the record here, that, see, I would make that argument. I'd say, that seems like a smell to me. Really, you have a list of free arguments that are just being passed as very rarely do you see arguments being packed along, maybe as an options list, JSON, of course, you know, big payloads. But in most well-defined APIs, you have, you know, argument foo, argument bar, argument baz. And to pass these along as a list or a tuple or a dict or something, a map, you know, that's a little weird. So that to me is a little bit of a smell, and I think it gets to your point. I think you could easily argue, and you could be right about this. I'm going to fall back to the subjective standard there. I think if we can agree, though, that if something is generally clearer and less ambiguous, it's better. And I would assert that most code that you throw a dart at on the wall is not that way. And so we have a much bigger problem than worrying about, you know, this specific context and that. So I will concede this. I think you could be right on that. How's that?
Okay.
All right. You won. All right. Yeah. Sorry.
Does it make sense to farm off single liners into separate functions and just write a comment? So we can comment support.
Yeah, so comments. You can't get the function call wrong and you can get the comment wrong. I mean, what percentage of comments are wrong? Is it zero? No. What percentage of comments is wrong? Has anyone done a study? The physicist here. It wasn't one of those questions. It wasn't it's between 0 and 100. I mean, comments are... Let's just give them credit. Let's give them credit for comments having some value here. I would say there's a certain percentage of them that will be inaccurate, and now you're having to maintain. It's similar to tests. There's some payoff there. Well, no, I disagree. It's not. Like, tests are executable and verifiable. Comments are just, you know, unless they embed code like Python, PyStrings, PyDoc. I use almost no comments. In fact, I really don't think I have any comments. And even documentation and private functions, I just like to get away from it. I like to get my eyes right into the code as quickly as possible, because that to me is where the action is. I would encourage you just to try it and see. I mean, honestly, let's take a step back here. Let's, rather than like, you know, creating dogma and religious, you know, order here, let's just propose this as something to experiment with and see if you like it. See if your colleagues like it. If you adopt it and improve things, keep it. And if you don't like it, toss it. Okay. Yeah. That's fair. Yeah. In that case, you can actually document the function as well, so it becomes a full feature. But having a function itself in the first place allows you to document. I skipped you.
Yeah. So it's interesting. When I saw the rich code originally, it was very obvious that constructing the args could fail. And in the reconstructed version, it was left, you hit a verify DB two calls down.
Yeah.
So when you read this,
is that a good?
Yeah,
I mean, I just want to make sure, is that a good thing, or are you arguing, is that...
I think that worry means that something that...
I'm not walking into a trap here. I feel like they're going to spring something on me. So you like that?
That was something that worried me a little bit.
With the first version or the second version?
The rewrite.
The rewrite, okay. Really? Okay, that's interesting. So you saw that. There was a number of things in that original that I didn't see that I only saw after I had been able to look at these functions squarely.
There were things definitely you pulled out and rewrite.
Yeah.
But I did completely missed.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So the observation was that in the original code, you spotted some things that were harder to spot in the other ones. Okay. Oh, I see. I see the abstraction. Yeah, the abstraction of creating that argument. Yeah, necessarily hid those. And you're arguing. I'm getting like 5 points here that's saying that's not a good thing. All right, I'm starting to get weak. You know, I'm starting to get weaker and crawl under here. So, if you want to see those arguments pop out, okay, let's just agree that I should have done that, and then we can. All right. Yeah. So the question is, why didn't I use two modules there?
Possibly even three, because then you have your generic header handling logging.
Yeah. Okay. So we have a decision to make. Do we put this on the same module, or do we create separate modules? Now, I think we're fully in the area of sort of reasoned options here. I have a personal bent to not abstracting when I don't need to. So I'm not going to simply speculate to say, okay, this is going to be a module that has my error handling logic. This is going to be a module that has... I tend to want to see one sort of logical operation under one roof. I could certainly see that, you know, a counterpoint to that, but I'd like to see a problem first. So, you know, the naive decision would be just to use one. Why would you use two when you could use one? So I used one, and until I see it breaking down, becoming a monolith, becoming confusing, becoming an actual noticeable problem, I'm probably not going to go after it. Now, knowing how to write software in Erlang helps you to pick the modules, and there's a canon, there's a certain canonical way of farming your modules out, and I think this is consistent with that, but that's a point we could possibly talk about. Yeah.